Once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. It packed my heart in love, and brought my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus left it right. Had a little talk with Jesus, tell him all about our troubles, he offended his cross, he'll answer by and by. Jesus makes it right. I may have thousand fears, my heart is filled with tears. Find Jesus the friend who watches day and night. I go to him in prayer, he knows my every pain. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Have a little talk with Jesus, tell him all about our troubles. He'll offend this cry, let's have by and by. Feel in prayer, we'll tell him, Lord, and if I spare you, we'll find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Beloved, I've told you of being in the Kalahari, going to preach to Bushmen. I've gone to Namibia, I've gone to Botswana, I've gone to South Africa several times, I've gone to different places, even out of this continent, in different places where there are none Adventists, to go and preach. I've done it. I know what it means. When I say I'm an Adventist, I know. And I want you to listen. Because an Adventist, like I told you, even just me wearing that robe can actually disturb you. That's an Adventist. Just that can disturb a person who says, no! That's an Adventist for you. No wonder, friends, I personally believe among the most argumentative people on the sea of glass who will say, but how come this one is here? Will be Adventists. Christ will have to tell them, chill, relax. They deserve to be here. Can I tell you something, beloved? Do you know that an Adventist, forgive me, I hope I'm not being recorded, please, if you are, check this out. Do you know that an Adventist believes the Pope can't be saved? Do you know that?
Yes.
An Adventist will tell you, it's impossible, impossible person. He can't, the Pope, oh. But do you know what the Bible tells me, friends? Whosoever we can be what? Can be saved. Ask people like the, is it Bud Jekler? What is his name now? I see him also on your Hope TV. But he's an Adventist, the preacher, you know him?
Do Bachelor,
I didn't know how to pronounce his name. Do Bachelor, they were classmates with Pope John Paul II. They're in the same class. And he talks about him, Bachelor, teaching the Pope desire of ages and great controversy. You know what I can tell you, brother? Sometimes we don't know how a person agonizes in his heart with his heart. We judge the outside, but God looks at the inside. That's the truth, brother. Some people that we have condemned and looked down on them, not knowing the beloved, God may be working in their hearts. You know when they tell you that salvation is a mystery, and salvation will be shocking. Because at best, beloved, what I can just advise you is, sort out your salvation, you and God, and that's what matters. Amen. If your eyes are looking round of this way, hey Lord, believe me, you will be lost. Amen. Are you getting what I'm telling you, beloved? I'm an Adventist. I know what I'm talking about. From here, I'll be going back home, of course, to go and sort out issues. You know, I told you I'm not even going to pay you. I have to go and sort out my rentals, see what I can do to sort out issues. Later on, I have to leave. I've been called to the same area where there are Muslims. It's an entered area. That's the ministry I've gone into. These are people that don't know Jesus Christ. These are people that there's no Seventh-day Adventist church. And we're trying to establish churches where the church is not there. And unfortunately, brothers, I must just be very honest and tell you aloud. I go in places where the field where we go, most times it is one of the fields in either Sudan or Uganda that ask to say, Pastor, can you come? They don't even have money to buy me an air ticket. They don't even have money to give me any allowance or nothing. I have to tell them my schedule, so to give me time, pastors, let me try to see if I can find money, then I'll come there. Because Uganda has also a problem with Adventism. During the reign of Idi Amin, that time when Idi Amin was president, there was a time that SDA was banned in the church. There was no SDA in Uganda. Read and ask the Ugandans, they'll tell you. It had to be brought back just recently. So they're just doing it now. So they require a lot of help, and we go into those unentered areas. Here's one testimony I'll tell you that when I started saying I'm an Adventist, because I want you to hear this. We went to preach in an area. I struggled to get my way there. I did. We got there. We drove with the church. When I reached there, actually, the first time, the church asked me, they said, Pastor, we don't even have people who can escort you. Because everyone who needs to escort you needs to be given an allowance. And we don't have money. So they asked me, can you pay them as a Zambian? I said, believe me, the only money I came with was a ticket to get me from Zambia into here and to get me back. I don't even have any coin on me. I said, okay, fine, but we'll organize some food for you. So they organize some food, we travel. Youths, that's why I love AY. AYs, they sacrificed, they told me, they said, Pastor, don't worry, us, we don't even need allowances. We'll go with you. And I went with the youths. They were the people I was with. We preached. One of the youths was interpreting. And he entered the area. No Seventh-day Adventist, nothing at all. We are starting it. The person who was interpreting for me, the voice went. Second person, the voice went. We had no interpreter now. And I couldn't speak their language. Guess who started interpreting for me? A Catholic priest. He came. We asked him, he said, we have a problem, we need someone to interpret. He says, don't worry. It's the word of God. After all, in us Catholic, we have problems with these people. But they are listening to you. Do you know why? Because I told you I was dressing like a Muslim. I had that the white thing, I had the robe like a Muslim. You see me actually as an Adventist. Oh, believe me, you would go to church for that discussion. That's an Adventist mind. No, that one is fallen. He's dressing like a Muslim. But I had to reach them. And I had to talk to them. A Catholic priest started interpreting, which to a Seventh-day Adventist, I'm an Adventist. Oh, they will tell you to say it is impossible. Catholic. These are sinners. These are going to hell. These don't know that he was interpreting. I asked the congregation, is he speaking what I'm speaking? They told me, exactly, Pastor. Exactly, Pastor. I said, oh, that's good. Now, here's the good news. Listen, beloved, we ran out of food. Remember, we're just on self-help. We ran out of food. It was a 4 weeks crusade. We can't do a short crusade because you're talking to people who don't know anything about Christ. You can't talk to them in 1 week. We keep talking. So we ran out of food. And we didn't know who was going to give us food. The Catholics started feeding us. The nuns. They took us on as their own. They started feeding us and providing food. One evening, beloved, in one of my sermons, I was to do the mark of the beast. The youths told me, they said, Pastor, you do this sermon, then we are not eating. Look for another sermon here. Let's change direction. I said, but I have to preach this. It's a part of the sermon. The youths kept looking at me. And even it was actually, I think it was a Friday. We agonized the whole time arguing. The youths told me, no, Pastor. This is the Catholic priest interpreting. Food is from the Catholic. They are the ones taking care of us in this area. Our church won't give us any food. You disturb them, Pastor, it's done. And this is what you want to do. We prayed about it. You know, the priest didn't know even the sermons I was preaching. His role was just to interact. Came many services. I stood up. I started preaching. I read Daniel. The youths were looking at me. I could see their eyes were popped. Now they were saying, this man is messing us up. I went to Revelation chapter 13. The man was interpreting. When I started explaining about the beast, I started explaining. Finally, I connected it to the Catholic Church. Believe me, friends, a man who was a Catholic priest, I expected him to be mute at that time now that he will stop interpreting. No, sir. The man could actually now even go further. Me, I would explain. You know, I remember there was a food issue, so I was being very careful. I was talking, but you know, scratching on top. You know what I mean, right? Instead of him also scratching on top, the guy started going deeper. He started explaining what the church does and what they did in the old time, in the catacombs and in the dark ages. He went down explaining. When we finished the message, we went to pray. The youths were wondering to say, today, today. But interestingly, friends, that's the day the Catholic even gave us chicken to eat. I told you I am an Adventist. I'm what? An Adventist. I know what I'm talking about, friends. We wanted to baptize, Pastor. So many people, a few, you know, it's very difficult to deal with them. But people have given themselves. Like now, I have a call to go and preach in a very dangerous place, in Mogadishu. How many go there? But honestly, I have that call. But sincerely, they just tell you to say, Pastor, please, we want you to come and do what you did. I said, but how will I come? They say, Pastor, don't even have money. We can't even bring you here. But find your way to come. How do I go? It's very difficult. But you know, we struggle sometimes. I get the same laptop, give it to somebody who holds it. I say, hold on, give me a minute, but I take it over. Beloved, I've learned minister requires sacrifice. At the end of the day, I want to ask you a question. What did you do with the wealth I gave you? You may not be there, Kabula, to travel in these areas, but believe me, you can support the pastor, Pastor Chipeka, your pastor here. There's also work here in Malawi. Support ministers and people who are preaching. It's important. The day came that I was supposed to baptize, and I was wondering, I was looking to this priest to say, let me see. But you know what the Muslims did? I don't know how the devil operated that day. He just knew that these guys were baptized. Friends, they switched off water completely in the whole compound. There was no water for almost a week. We didn't even realize it because we had water in cans and in the drums and we were drinking, you know, we had our own water put separately. But they closed off the water. So the day came to baptize pastor, there was nowhere to baptize. I had members who gave themselves to say, pastor, why don't you be baptized? Some were even saying, oh, just lay your hands on us. The Catholic priest said, pastor, it's very easy. That's why us Catholics have made a shortcut. You can go that route and it will be easier for you. I said, that's not how Adventists baptize. We go under the water. I had to leave them unbaptized and walked out. But I promised, I said, I'll come back. That was last year. And believe me, friends, I almost died last year. I've actually seen the end of it. Because somehow, I think the devil just hit me where it mattered most. My blood pressure did not drop. I was just in a situation. I went to a private clinic, they gave me medication, but unfortunately they gave me wrong medication. In the process, my kidneys collapsed. The doctors actually, at that private clinic, actually announced, they said, no, there's nothing we can do, take him to the bigger hospital. It's like a transit point, when they know there's nothing, this guy is dying, so they take you to the other hospital. I don't know, but God was merciful. Somehow he resuscitated me. And immediately when I just picked up, I was a bit okay, weak. I wasn't preaching for almost about 5 months. I was off the pulpit. I just mentioned, I said, when I was coming here to say, I'm just picking up actually to do this, because this was happening last year between November, December, those January was when I was picking up actually. So the first call I received is from the Catholic guys in that same area. He calls me, he says, pastor, this church that you left is growing now. But remember you told us to come and baptize. And I said, there's this man in the Holy Ghost now. And how do I go there? And I'm sick, and there's corona. But the work has to go on. You know, when we talk about the second coming of Jesus, I'm not going to look around. I'm an Adventist. There are places, friends, that we still need to reach. That's the truth. Don't be mesmerized with Malawi if you see Manja has Chechi, Naperi has Chechi, you know, all these areas. You know what I'm talking about? So we get to a point where we're comfortable, say, the church is good. Jesus, no, friends. There are people who don't know nothing. In Sudan, the church has problems. They don't even have the money. I found my fellow pastor who we were walking together on foot. He looked at me and says, but you are too fat. I said, yes, I know, but let's do this work. There's nothing we can do. Let's walk. I start teaching my fellow pastor ministry in the field. This is how it is done. This is how it's done. The church is established like this. This is. Then he says, even our field can't even reach here because they have no money. They can't come. Our church. I want to appeal to you, Seventh-day Adventists, to people from Kabula, from West Bank, from Pioneer Hill, reconcile yourselves. Because I know how Adventists are. Camp meeting, before I start to preach, I want a reconciliation message on the Sabbath. Because sometimes as churches, there are differences. Pioneer Hill, if there are any differences you have had with West Bank, let this be your reconciling time. Let the Lord reconcile you. Kabula Hill, if you have differences with West Bank, reconcile. Pioneer, if you have differences with Kabula, I don't know what those differences may be. I'm a stranger. I'm not here. I've not even talked to anybody who has told me about this, but I'm telling you, why do I tell you? Because I know Adventists. I'm an Adventist. I know how we are. Little differences that even come meeting, somebody says, no, me, I can't attend. Come meeting in Kabula. I can't. Reconcile. If you can't reconcile here on earth, how will you sit together in the courts of heaven? So I'm going to have a prayer today. My prayer is for these three churches. And I'm praying for reconciliation. Bringing these churches together. So that together, you can work as one family of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Set your differences out. That can help, beloved friends. You can win an argument but lose a soul. What have you won? Nothing. So let this be a moment of reconciliation, Pastor. I will ask Pastor Chipeka and our district pastor to come. The two of us, the two of them, will pray short prayers for reconciliation. Somebody asked me a question, friends, that I almost failed to answer, but it was on phone. Elders, I don't know, I didn't even intend to say this. But he asked me a question. He says, Pastor, I want to help where you go to preach and to just support the ministry that you do. Beloved, you may not go with me, you may not be there, but believe me, your finances may help in this way. So I usually work through this with the personal ministries. Brother Don, I ask you to stand. I actually mentioned to Brother Don about it, right? Yeah, and Fanuel. Please, Fanuel, you may stand as well. So, brothers, your surnames, I may not pronounce it properly, so I call you his names. I hope it's not embarrassing in Malawi. We are used, right? So I usually work this out through the personal ministry, because personal ministry, they are the ones who are involved into this preaching. Sometimes, how we have worked it out, like I would advise, is they can get a MasterCard, then people can put in the money. When I'm going there, that side, we are able to access that money and use it in those projects where we go to preach. I beg you, friends, I'm not saying stop doing other things, but I'm praying as the Spirit of the Lord leads you, you have extra tambara, extra kwacha, you want to support this week, the personal ministry are here. And they'll support it, who receive it will go. The work has to be done. That's the truth, beloved, and the Lord will richly bless you. Shall we stand for a reconciliation prayer? Let's pray.
Our God and our Father, the Creator of the universe, Father, we understand that at the cross, the ground is leveled. And that is why we are standing on our feet, acknowledging how powerful you are. To say yes, in the church there can be Jews, there can be Gentiles. But through the blood of Jesus Christ, you are able to reconcile those whom deemed and we are seen to be irreconcilable. We understand that people have talked about irreconcilable differences. But with your power, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we are praying for Pioneer Hill. We are praying for Kabula. That Father, as we pray, may you reconcile each one of us and as a church, also particularly as individuals, by forgiving each one of us, so that we should find forgiveness at your throne of grace.
Amen.
Our differences may not be known, but there is nothing hidden before you. In the church at Corinth, chapter 1, verse 10, 11, Paul was preaching the same message to say in the church, some were claiming to belong to Apollos, some were claiming to belong to Paul. But Paul was saying, who is Apollos and who is Paul? Father, finally, Paul was appealing to that church that although some belong to Paul, some belong to Apollos, but they all belong to Christ. May we all belong to Christ at this moment as we are waiting for your soon coming. Father, we may speak and speak, but without being humble to you and presenting ourselves to you, there are some of us, we feel we are big that we can't forgive. Help us to humble ourselves so that through forgiveness we may find peace. As Elder Mtuzi, Pastor, continues to pray, Father, may we find grace.
Loving Heavenly Father, I also commit the West Bank in your hands. As these three churches are here today, some are watching online, make us one. Because you told us through your manservant Paul that in your church there is no Jew, there is no Gentile, there is no female, there is no male, but they are all one in Jesus Christ. We want that oneness, Father, to continue. These three churches have projects. It could be that during the course of these projects, maybe one or two might need something from the other. Let us be open-handed. We assist each other so that your work can progress. Lord, the West Bank is connected to Kabula, as good as connected to West Bank and to Pioneer Hill. And it is our prayer, Lord, that spiritually, make us one. Socially, make us one. Mentally, let's work together as one entity. Lord, this is a special occasion that comes once in a while. Maybe one of our members in one of these churches was offended and even thinking of leaving the church. May today's program bring that soul back to us, back to you, so that we move together as we are looking forward to thy soon coming. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. Be it, Lord, that we have said that touch the most itching areas, but thy Holy Spirit can do that. So do it for us, so that we move together as we are looking forward to thy soon coming. For this we pray and live in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. My message this morning comes from the book of Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. I'll temporarily move out of the book of Daniel. Out of the book of Daniel. I hope to pick up later on Daniel, like the elder asked to say. I still have unfinished business with Daniel. I agonized with the Lord in prayer to ask God, what is the message for Kabula? What's the message for Pioneer Hill? And what's the message for West Bank? Before I preach this message, my brothers, I just want to bring to your attention that in the years as a preacher, I have learned not to preach to church members. I have learned to preach to myself. When I stand to speak, I speak to myself. Because sincerely, friends, I don't want to be a cast out. I don't want to be a cast out. I don't want to hear words that I never knew. After I have toiled, God tells me I don't know. God, that's not my prayer. There are times when people say, I want to tell you, or he's telling the church. Of course we say that maybe as we preach, but sincerely, for me, even when I'm talking passionately on certain things, it's because I'm talking to myself. And I pray that as I talk to myself, may the Spirit of the Lord talk to you as well. That together as a family, we can be saved. I don't speak to you, beloved, like one who is very holy. I have faults. I have shortcomings. I am wicked like you. I need the blood of Jesus. I need his grace, just like you need it. So together, friends, we have no business to judge each other. Our business is to accept him so that he can save us. So as I speak this morning, friends, I'll be talking to myself and I'll be talking to you. But this I know, the Holy Spirit will speak to our hearts. Galatians 5. Galatians chapter 5, reading verse 7. Galatians chapter 5, reading verse 7. If we have opened and found it, let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
Are we sure? Amen?
Amen?
Amen. The Bible says, Paul is writing to the church in Galatia. He says, you reign well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? Some translations say, you were running well. Who hindered you? Ye did run well, but who hindered you? Some have good English. They say, you were performing well, but who disturbed you that you should not obey the gospel? Others make it right for our generation. They say, you were working well. Everything was excellent. But who confused you? The title of my message this morning, who hindered you? You are running well. You started well. Everything was going well. But what happened? What happened? You were singing well. You were a good church elder. You were a good youth. Oh, you were a good lady. A good doctor's worker. You were a good pastor, a good preacher, mighty man of God. But who hindered you? What disturbed you? Paul seems to be speaking about a race. And he's talking about a finishing line that each one has to reach and accomplish the goal. And Paul is saying, look, when the race started, when you started running, there was no problem. You were doing well. You were running well. And in many cases, you will hear Paul refers to this salvation as a race. He says there's a prize that must be won. He speaks, let us run with endurance. Let us do things like one who received a prize. Why? Paul is talking about we are in a race. You are running. The prize is sure. You were running well. You were performing well. You were reading well. You were praying well in your life. Who hindered you? What disturbed you, friend? Even before I can digest this message, beloved, it just breaks me down. Because honestly, friends, I have told you, I mentioned it in one of my sermons, I said, it is important to live right, but
it is more important to die right. Dying right is important. We start out well, oh, yes, very good, flourishing like a flower. Oh, beautiful woman. Oh, doing everything. But who hindered you? When getting married, we have all good aspirations. Oh, I'll be a good wife. I'll kneel for my husband. I'll cook for him. Whatever he wants, I'll be there. I'll be a loving, gentle wife. Who hindered you? Who hindered you, my sister? What has changed, my brother? You looked at that woman in her eyes and said, till death do us apart. Give her that ring. You give her your love. You give her your heart. My best choice! But today, as I'm talking to you, beloved, your eyes are all over. You have promised to us and living an immoral life. Who hindered you? What has happened? What has happened, brother? You are preaching well. Oh, you are being called everyone in this. Hey, Malawi, let's call that one. Hey, let's call that one. Always blowing. Always this preacher. Where is that one? You were performing well. Who hindered you? That's the question Paul is asking. You are almost finishing the race. The Galatian church, everything was going on right. But who hindered you? Brother Samson, you started well. God chose you as a Nazarite. God told you, your hair is not to be cut, Samson. God told you, Samson, there are certain foods and wines that you're not supposed to bring and intoxicate yourself. You are a liberator of Israel. Oh, good. The Bible tells me Samson would shake himself. And as he shakes himself, the Spirit of the Lord would fall on Samson. He would kill 1,000,000 with a jawbone in his hand. The Philistines, he destroyed their camps. Brother Samson, who hindered you? Who hindered you? When you are doing it so well. Samson, so powerful, he lifted the gates one evening. When he went to see a prostitute in a town and they locked him in that city, he lifted the gates heavy on his arms and his shoulders for a kilometer up the mountains, many kilometers, and left it there. Beloved, Samson had the power to lift a heavy gate, but had no power to lift his heart out of prostitutes. Samson could kill 1,000,000 people with bare hands without using any weapon, and yet could not kill his lust for immorality. Who hindered you? Who hindered you? Delilah. In these last days, beloved, the devil knows. If he can't get us as Adventists through deals and wrong kinds of intoxicating beverages, we are not drinking alcohol, we are not smoking, we are not doing anything else, he knows there is a Delilah. Delilah! Samson fell. Who hindered you? You are doing well. Brother Samson, finally, you have to die with the Philistines when you are a liberator of Israel, with that holding, breaking down the temple of Dagon. Who hindered you? Israel cries out for a king. They said, God, we want a king like any other nation. Samuel agonizes with Israel. He says, but God is your king. You don't need a king. But they pressed him, until God finally says, okay, let's give them a king. And there was a gentleman. The Bible says he stood shoulder high among everybody else. A man who had an excellent spirit. One who was good, doing things excellently, brilliant, intelligent, a warrior. a soldier, a man of vigor and mighty valor. Everybody looked up to him. His name was Saul.
And indeed, beloved, when he came to meet Samuel, with looking for donkeys, that was his business, looking for the father's donkeys that God had lost. But when he got to Samuel, Samuel anoints him. And he says, you're king over Israel. You started well. God says, behold, this is Saul. Samuel introduces him. This is the king of Israel. But who hindered you? Who hindered you, Samuel? Saul. That suddenly, beloved, when Saul goes into battle, everybody would be shouting out, they would say, Saul has killed a thousand. Saul has killed a thousand. He was so mesmerized, proud, and pomp was coming into him. I have done it. I have done it. Not until one day, beloved, a young boy, David, kills Goliath. And when he kills Goliath, Israel is returning from a victorious battle. The expectation of Saul is to hear the message, Saul has killed a thousand. Yes, they sang. Saul has killed a thousand. Saul has killed a thousand. But they came to David and said, but David has killed 10,000. 10,000. And when Saul looked at David, he grew envy. He grew jealousy. Jealousy is dangerous. And he desired in his heart, I must kill this young boy. Read the story. He tries it over and over to kill David. Finally, beloved, the Spirit of the Lord leaves King Saul, a man who started excellence. Who hindered you? Who hindered you? God gives him an assignment. Go and destroy the Amalekites. He goes into battle. Instead of doing exactly what God says, he decides to do his own personal issues. He spares what God says destroy. Beloved, there are things God has told you destroy in your life. There are things that God has told you get rid of them in your life. There are things God has said out. But today as I'm talking to you, I ask you a question. Have you spared the wrong things? Who hindered you? Finally, Samuel comes over and he tells him, what meaneth the bleating, the longing, and the crying of the oxen that I hear? You have not performed the work of the Lord. You haven't done it. God has rejected you. Finally, in that battle where the Philistines, as Saul is fighting, he discovers the Spirit of the Lord has left him. Alas, my brother, Saul has to get a sword. He lays it down there to try and commit suicide by sleeping on it. It can't happen. He has to ask an Amalekite who is passing by, and he pleads with him, chop off my head that I may die. Who hindered you? You started well. He dies a hopeless death. A needless death! Let's get home now. It's Good Friday yesterday. Today we call it Holy Saturday. Who hindered you? Brother Judas had an opportunity, golden opportunity, chosen as one of the 12 disciples, walked with Christ. Everywhere they were together. He saw blind Bartimaeus cry out, Jesus, save me! Oh, beloved, Judas should have joined in the chorus and simply said, even me too, even me too. While on others thou art calling, do not pass over me. But instead, Judas is among those who stand blind Bartimaeus, shut up, when he needed to join the chorus. He's there when that lady touches Jesus' cloak and she's healed. He's there when Jesus Christ calls out for Lazarus, come forth. He should have told Jesus to say, I'm also in the tomb of sin. Break this tomb that I may come out. But his love for silver, his love for money, just like many of us, beloved, little do we realize it, friends, that our love for money, we betray him. Our failure to return faithful tithes and offerings, we are no better than Judas. We are betrayers.
you are busy amassing wealth all over. Meanwhile, you can't even support God's work anywhere in your life. Judas. When they are anointing Jesus on his, Mary is pouring that oil on Jesus' legs, and Judas looks, then Judas responds. You know what the Bible speaks about in Matthew? It simply says, and they said, what a waste. Meaning we have wasted this on him. He doesn't point out anybody, simply says, they said. And Mark is a bit specific in his writing, because Mark says, the disciples said, what a waste. But John, he points him out. He says, and one of the disciples, Judas, said, what a waste. I ask you today, beloved, my dear sister, when your husband says, I want to give to church building, do you tell him what a waste? When he wants to return a faithful tithe, what a waste. He wants to help his father and mother in the village or his brothers and sisters, you say, what a waste. What a waste! That was Judas, my dear sister. Don't be a Judas in that home. My brother, don't be a Judas in your life. And you know what? Because Judas had evaluated Jesus. He looked at him, and he says, this guy is worth 30 pieces of silver. Here, I can make money. And like this same whatever Easter period that we call, what did Judas do? He kissed him. 30 pieces of silver. Today, I ask you a question. What have you given in exchange for Jesus? Have you gotten the 30 pieces of silver? Who hindered you? Judas finally, beloved, from one of the good disciples, Judas has to go and crucify himself. Paul talks about a man called Demas in the book of Timothy. He says, Demas, we were working together. Demas, we were preaching together. We were moving from place to place together. Then he tells Timothy, he says, Timothy, leave Demas. Leave him alone. He has loved the world much more than the gospel. Let him stay. You started well, Demas. You were with Paul. You were preaching. You were all over. But who hindered you? When you look through your life, my brother, when you look through your life, my sister, who hindered you? What is it, beloved? The day we were baptizing you. Look at how you were bowing to God. Look at how you are giving your life to God. Look at how you are dedicating your life to God. Look at how determined you were for God. What has happened today? Who hindered you? What has changed? You're supposed to be better, but you're getting worse. Beloved, sin has unavoidable consequences. One day you will pay. Payday someday. My dear friends, let us examine our lives and think through. God never called us, friends, that we may judge one another. God never called us that we may laugh at one another. But God called us to examine each other. To examine yourself, oneself, look at yourself. Because in this life, friends, when you think you are standing, look at yourself, maybe you are falling. That's the truth about life, friends. Because in this life, we don't know. You don't know that man you laugh at, you say, that one is always a chain smoker. That one drinks alcohol. That one is a thief, he's a dealer. That one is a dirty, crooked politician, useless. Oh, that one is a womanizer. He changes women like clothes. He's out there. Forget about him. You don't know. I tell you, brothers, you don't know. You don't know. You don't know, my sister, you don't know. Maybe. You don't know what he does in his private moment when he sits alone agonizing and talking to his God. You are not there. You are not there! You don't know! That's friends, salvation happens between the beer hall and the church hall. Somewhere there, things are happening. Because Jesus is in the business of saving souls. You don't know.
I preached in one crusade, beloved, and there was a drunk, real drunk. And he came to that crusade drunk in his drunken stupor. And every time when he comes drunk, he sits. Sometimes when I'm preaching, he even shouts, "Amen, Pastor, preach!" The elders told me, they said, "No, no, no, this guy, Pastor, disturbs you." And he liked not to sit at the back. He would make sure he comes to sit in front. And I was in a foreign place. You know, you can't see he's making noise, but I kept on preaching. So they asked me, the deacons would struggle to try and bully me, he refused. He says, leave me here, and they would leave him finally. So I had to tell the deacons, I said, no, leave him, because you disturb the service when you're struggling with him. So they left him, drank every day, until, beloved, tomorrow we're having a baptism, the crusade is coming to an end. It was Sabbath, like today. Oh, church is packed. Who do I see coming? The drunken soup. This time, not drunk. He comes normal. He comes, he sits right in front. When the chairs are finished, at times he'll sit on the floor here in front. I start to preach. I make an appeal. I plead it. This is my last appeal. Today, the crusade comes to an end. I told them, you know what? The same message that I preached. Others have gotten salvation. Others have lost it. Because truth be told, beloved, that this same message that I have preached in Kabula Hill, in Pioneer Hill, and in West Bank stands as a witness either for you or against you. Because in the judgment, God will remind you, you heard him. I spoke to you. What hindered you? I preached. Same message. I made an appeal. He was already seated in front, so he simply stood. Beloved, others joined him in front. We registered names for people to get baptized that day. The service ended, we went behind, and we started quickly trying to examine those names. And you know what? I find a very sad story. Because they left the brother, the drunkard man, standing by himself. Everybody else, they took them into the vestry. He remained standing there. I asked, I said, "But where is that gentleman?" They said, "Oh, Pastor, he has remained. I know, that one, Pastor, forget about him. Don't worry about him. Let's sort out this." I said, "No, but I'm worried about him. Because these two." I walked into the church. I called the brother, who was standing by himself. The chorister is choristering. He was just standing there. I looked at him, and his tears were in his eyes. And the man simply told me, "Pastor, I want to be baptized today. Pastor, I had my last beer last night, and I bid farewell to alcohol. I want Jesus now, Pastor." I got him, I said, "Let's go. You'll get baptized." I told the elders, "Ooh, I'm an Adventist." What did I tell you, beloved? I am an? Come on, help me. I am an Adventist. Pastor, this one has not even been in Bible class. Pastor, this one has not even done any baptismal class. He doesn't know anything. I said, "The eunuch, how much did he know in Bible class?" Philip just preached to him in the chariot. And he says, "I see water." And he says, "I must be baptized." Similar to the story that the pastor yesterday told us, Pastor Chpe. I pushed, I said, "Let him get baptized." He got baptized. Came out of the water. Beautiful. The man walked around excited, rejoicing in the Lord. I pastored in some rural area. I was a young pastor, single at that time. Beloved, I read to you a verse that talks about removing a jacket. Do you remember? Mm-hmm. Eh? It's there in the Bible, Adventist. I have to justify.
Please, go ahead.
Somebody will hear now to say, "No, that is something I don't ever call you. He's uncompetent." I know, that's an Adventist. I know. He preaches well, but no, no, no. He needs to get converted. So you say, why? The way he dresses. Okay, fine. If I don't dress well, I'm in that girl. Buy me a suit. All right. I was pastoring in a rural area, a church. There were several churches, pastor. I was a young guy. I just joined the ministry. I think that was in the year 2000. I joined in 96, but that was 2000. Had some bit of experience. And it was in the bush. Because in that, you know how ministry is dynamic. In our countries, I don't know Malawi, but when you're just a young pastor, I was just doing, oh, they can give you in town. No, in rural. Bush! That's where you begin from as a youth. In fact, I remember my president even looking at me. He says, you're energetic. That's why you need to go in the bush. And I was in the bush without even a vehicle, not even a bicycle, nothing. Walking distances to go and do God's work as a pastor. And you know, I still see today even some people are very excited. They say, no, people who started this church were walking. Even Pastor Jones needs to walk. No, guys, time has changed. Yourself, you don't walk. When you see him driving his little car that can jump anywhere, sometimes he can even stop anywhere and say, no, that is humble. That's not humble, that's humiliation you did before. Yourself, you have vehicles that you have parked at home that you don't even drive. They're just for prestige. All these are mine. And if the pastor doesn't even have a proper vehicle, come on, friend. Look at your friends, the Pentecostals, Kabula. Let that be your challenge. Let somebody, even when an MP or the minister or somebody comes to some visiting Kabula, let them visit the pastor and say, wow. You know what, friends? Let blessings be seen because God is blessing. Not when you look at somebody, even told Pastor Jones, he says, join SDA. Somebody says, this church I can't, the way he looks, he's the shoes, they even look white. And polished. He's dressed in his, because beloved, you have let us to dishonor and to sometimes to even embarrass God, because people judge the church by how they look at us as ministers. That's on 5-7. So beloved, I went to, I was preaching in that area, things were going on well as a pastor. Remember my sermon is, who hindered? So what happened one day? We were to have a huge camp meeting and it was an inter-district camp meeting. Young pastor. Started organizing. Then I said, we need to organize a choir. Huge choir to sing. There was also a choir that was coming from the city of Lusaka to come and bless the occasion. So we needed our own local choir also to pick up. So I started organizing this choir. I asked the churches around, can you give me a name of a person who can lead this choir and is a good guy who can do it? There is proposed names, and finally somebody told me, he says, pastor, there's a gentleman. His name is Tyson. What name? Tyson. I didn't hear Malawi. What name? Tyson. They told me Tyson. That was one person. He says, pastor, Tyson is a good singer. He's gifted. He knows music. He can lead the choir. But there's a problem, pastor. I said, oh, sure. He says, you know what? Tyson has been disfellowshipped, pastor, 3 times with the same guest. Every time he's baptized and is given a choir to lead, women in the choir suffer. At one point, he impregnated 3 women, including somebody's wife. I said, oh, Tyson is dangerous. So we baptized him the second time. He led a choir. We thought Tyson is converted. Again, Tyson did the same thing. And we baptized him the 3rd time. Right now, as I'm talking, pastor, Tyson is disfellowshipped because of the same issues. But he's the best. I kept quiet. I started thinking. I said, God help. I started praying in my private moments for Tyson. He was coming to church, but disfellowshipped member. Not conducting any choir. You know, I'm an Adventist. To let him know where he belongs. No activity. Stay there. On a block of ice. I'm an Adventist. Are you following me, beloved? They packed him. I went to his church. It was somewhere in the bush, somewhere far. I traveled there. I got there. I met Tyson. I spoke to him. He said, pastor, It's the first time that somebody has come to speak to me one-on-one. We spoke. I prayed with him. I asked him his weaknesses. What was his problem? Remember, I was also a single pastor. We conducted a crusade prior to the camp meeting. My mind was fixed to say, in this crusade, Tyson has to get baptized. Are you following me? I need him for the choir, for the camp meeting. So I even told him, I said, Tyson, you need to get ready for baptism. We'll see. I am an Adventist. They gave themselves for baptism. People came in front. Tyson was one of them who walked in front. When the church saw him, it was inter-district. You know, the same way you have Kabula here, you have West Bank, you have Pioneer here, they're all here. They looked. And everybody says, they started now pointing. Why is it? They said, this one is ready. He said, let's see what will happen today. Husbands are already told by their wives, if you hear Tyson, don't. And in fact, when the wife says, no, baptize Tyson, he says, what's your interest? Tyson goes out even with married women. Are you offering? Quarrels around, so Tyson has been banished. In our language, Tyson was a leper. A leper. He comes in front. I receive them. We go to the river to go and, before we go to the river to go and be baptized, we meet with elders. Elders board this court. We're examining names. Oh, the name of Tyson comes up. They read it. Oh, Tyson, so, to get baptized. And the elder was chairing, asked the question, anybody who has anything to say? Everyone's hand was up. The elder asked, why is everyone's hand? They said, no, Pastor. Tyson, no, it's not time. If anything, Tyson has not yet gotten converted. You know, sometimes I look at Adventists, like they have a thermometer that measures salvation. That's a common measure to say, but the temperature. They measure! That's an Adventist. So they said, this one tithes! I was in that meeting. Remember, I've got interest. Are you following me, friend? I'm in that meeting. I have interest. I stood up. I said, no, Tyson has to get baptized, friends. Yeah, I spoke to him. I explained. I spoke to him on a long conversation. He gave himself. I prayed with him. And he has promised me that he will check. They just told me. They said, Pastor, you don't even know Tyson yourself. You just come here. And you're in this district. I remember one of the elders telling me, because at that time I had not even gotten married. There was a lady that I was almost seeing to marry and as a fiancé. This elder even tells me, he says, Pastor, you play with Tyson. He really impregnates that fiancé of yours, then you will know. I said, this Tyson is dangerous. Here I might be dying with me, an enemy. But whatever the case, beloved, I forced it. I said, well, let him be baptized. He passed through the elders' board. I was not ordained that time to baptize. We went to the river to go and baptize. I'd taken over that district from one of the senior pastors. They had divided the district. The senior pastor was on the north, I was on the south side. But that senior pastor, at some point, that used to be one district. So he knew the district very well, including Tyson. He knew him because it used to be one district. He's busy baptizing. And you know the song? On Jordan's stormy banks I stand and cast away shore rise. They're baptizing. Amen! Amen! Tyson stands now with his next. The pastor, when he was baptizing, looked up and saw Tyson. Then he asked everyone to say, oh, stop. Let the music, wait a minute. Where's the district pastor? They called for me. I was somewhere else. They said, no, let him come. I walked near him. Then he says, Pastor, just come close. I removed my shoes. I walked into the water. And then he asked me, Tyson is standing on the banks. He hasn't even come into the waters of the river. Then the pastor asked me, he says, Pastor, are you sure you want to baptize Tyson? I said, yes, he has given himself. He says, oh, Pastor, do you know that word? 3 times I baptized. 3 times disclosure, same scene. And the West, he even tells me, the West is the first time he impregnated one girl. Second time, 2 girls. Third time, it was the 3 women. This 4th time, you don't know how many now. Then he tells me, he says, if we baptize him, whoa,
pray and get baptized. I can imagine Tyson standing on the banks just looking like that. And everybody's, you know, there's silence. Everyone is just looking at you. You're the course out now. Everyone's talking. See, even those who are seated in sheds and trees, enjoying themselves, they realize their silence and they ask, why are you quiet? Then they say, it's Tyson. And everybody comes around me. They want to see, why is Tyson? They want to know what's happening. Oh, finally, beloved. The pastor calls him. He says, Tyson, come in. Tyson walks in the water. There are three of us. There's me, the pastor, and Tyson. And Tyson is standing in the water. Oh, that I beg. Please. Just stand in the way the baptismal candidate stands. You are not Tyson, pastor. I want you to see. Then the pastor is about to baptize. He holds him on the shoulders. Then he lifts his hand. He says, Tyson, I'm going to baptize you. This was special baptism. I want you to listen. He lifts his hand. Then he hits him on the head. Tyson, I baptized you the first time in the name of the Father. You fell. He lifts his hand again. Hits him on the head. Tyson, I baptized you the second time in the name of Jesus Christ. You fell. He lifts the hand. I baptized you in the third time in the name of the Holy Spirit. Again, you fail. Then he asks the question. He says, now, Tyson, you have finished all the names. In which name now am I going to baptize you? You have finished all the names. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I was standing looking. I begged. I said, Pastor, please baptize me. I kept on whispering, Pastor, please baptize him. I saw tears running in the eyes of Tyson. The pastor baptized him. Friends, there was even no anger. It was just quiet. Everybody just looked. Tyson walks out of the water. He almost got discouraged. He told me, Pastor, let me just forget about this thing. I encouraged him. I said, no, Tyson, you have to do it. And I brought him to the choir. I introduced him. Thank God the choir was very receptive because they knew his talent and his skill. They welcomed him. He started coaching the choir in readiness for the camp meeting. We had a beautiful music concert and a successful camp meeting. Tyson was there, doing well. I made Tyson my personal friend. I was a single pastor. He was also single. Sometimes he would come to sleep at the pastor's house. I would be with him throughout. I would be going to visit churches. I would be moving around with Tyson. He became my friend. I helped him, talking to him, strengthening him. As things go, I was transferred out. I went to another district. I stayed out 10 years later. I was sent to that district. This time not as a district pastor, but I was sent as a speaker for the camp meeting, the first speaker. I went there. Unfortunately, the district pastor was sick and he wasn't around. So they asked the head elder, like McDonald, to say, take the position of the pastor and introduce him and whatever is happening on the Sabbath. Sabbath came, the church was packed, people were singing, and we stood in front here. Beloved, would you guess who came out as the head elder for the whole entire district? Tyson! He stood and introduced me. He looked at me. I had even forgotten him 10 years later. He looked at me and he says, Pastor, do you remember me? I couldn't. Then he says, Pastor, I am Tyson. Tyson! I hugged him and I saw, even as an elder, 10 years later, tears were in his eyes. He says, had it not been for you, Pastor, I was lost. What am I saying to you, Kabula? What am I saying to you, Palmia? Don't judge. Don't judge! You don't know, beloved friends. You don't know. There are Tysons who are listening to me right now. There are Tysons who are here. You have judged them because they are alcoholics. You have judged them because they drink and smoke. Other sheep I heard. Which are out of this fold? They'll hear my voice and they'll come. There'll be one flock. Let the preacher now close. Lord. Listen, this is our closing remarks. When Israel was in battle, they finished the battle. at the end of the battlefields, they all gathered. And when they gathered, beloved friends, it was time now for a census to be done. Moses asked, count the people. Count the people! In the book of Numbers, the book is Numbers, chapter 31, verse 49. Count the people! And they quickly returned back to Moses and told him, they said, Moses, we have numbered the people. We have counted the people. We have counted the soldiers. And none is missing. Kabula, Kabula, Kabula. Pioneer, West Bank. Hear the message from the Lord. We have numbered the people. We have counted the people. And none is missing. As Corona is ravaging us, friends, when this life is over, God will say, count the people. My prayer for you, my brother, do not miss in that number. My dear sister, don't miss in the number. Because right now, as I talk to you, friends, there are people who should have been seated in this audience or watching me right now talk, but they are missing. They are missing. Some are just lost. Who hindered you? They are not in church today. We numbered the people. Who is missing? Who is missing, Pioneer? Some, COVID took them. Some, sin has taken them. Some, they have loved the world much more than God. What has hindered you? I beg, please, friends. In God's final roll call, nobody from Kabula, nobody from Pioneer Hill, no one, beloved, from West Bank should be missing. When the Savior calls, I want you to answer presence. When Jacob was old now, he was about to die, he called his 12 sons, the sons of Jacob, sons of Israel, 12 tribes. He blessed them, all 12. When he killed each one of them, the sons were answering, present dad, present dad, present dad. Each son was there. Throughout the whole entire Old Testament, 19 times the Bible lists the tribes of Israel responding, present, 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 present. But finally, beloved, the book of Revelation, chapter 7. When God makes his final roll call, John says, behold, I saw them standing on the sea of glass around the throne room of God. John says in Revelation 7, God calls out the final roll call. Oh, alas, my friends. Alas, two tribes are missing. They were there in the Old Testament. There, when Israel was blessing them. There, with their father Jacob. But in the book of Revelation, two tribes are missing. What happened? They are lost. The tribe of Ephraim is missing. The tribe of Dan is missing. The question I have for Kabula, the question I have for Pioneer and West Bank, who hindered you? You were running well. You were answering present throughout, but who has hindered you? I ask my, that bothers me personally, beloved, as a preacher and as a Christian. You preached in Kabula. You preached in Sochi. You preached in South Africa. You preached in Botswana. You preached in Congo. You preached all over Roni. But the final, God says, I don't know.
I don't know you. Depart from me.
I ask God, what good will it be? Lord, look, I'm sweating. I'm even hypertensive. Sometimes I even do this thing hungry, without anything. But then at the end you tell me I don't know you. Depart from me. Find your Roko! Will you answer present? Here's my appeal now, friends. Is it your desire, when the roar is called up yonder, to answer present? Is it your prayer today, somebody who is saying, Pastor, when this roar call is called, I want my name to be there. I want to answer present. I want to hear the words, well done, good and faithful servant. We have a baptism right now. Will be baptizing. I have never seen anyone who chose Jesus and they regret it. People are glad they know the Master. And I'm glad to tell you, friends, he doesn't say, go wash yourself and clean yourself and come. He says, come the way you are. Let us reason together. The pianist can give us a song, because now I'm making an appeal. Is there somebody in our midst? Somebody who is saying, Pastor, before you pray, I want to be baptized. I'm looking for a last bond for the kingdom of God. Somebody who says, I want to answer present. Because here is the fact, beloved, unless a man is born again, he or she cannot see the kingdom of God. You can't answer present. You need to be born again. So my brother, are you born again? My sister, are you baptized? What hinders you? Your boyfriend? Your girlfriend? Your job? Your parents? Your beliefs? Your church? Your pastor? What hinders you from obeying the gospel? All those who are baptized, let me see your hand shoot up. You're baptized, let me see your hand. I want you to turn and look at your neighbor's hand. This is not too embarrassing, but look at your neighbor's hand. Thank you, we may drop our hands. If your neighbor's hand is down, I want you to help the preacher. Talk to your neighbor right now. Just say, brother, my sister, do you want to be baptized? As I ask the congregation to be upstanding, friends, for last closing prayer, shall we stand? Somebody right now, you have heard. I've given you an opportunity to speak. Speak to somebody and say, do you want to be baptized? I want to invite all the 7 elders of Pioneer Hill, elders of West Bank, elders of Kabula, please come in front. And I want you to face the congregation. Pastor, do we have the baptism candidates here?
Yes.
Those who have given themselves to be baptized, I want you to come and join the elders in front. Those who have registered on this list, let's come, walk in front. As these are coming, I want to open the appeal to somebody who is saying, Pastor, I also want to walk in front. Those who want to join them right now, the Spirit of the Lord has spoken to you and you want to come in front. I want you to join also, come in front. You want to come even in this last minute, just walk in front. I do this work, but honestly, I feel the Spirit of the Lord using me. That's the truth, friends. There are moments when I've really pleaded for somebody to come for the last minute. And sometimes I've had tragedy strikes, whether they've accepted or not. Some people have died at a point when they needed to make the right decision. And I feel that spirit is upon me right now. Before I pray, my mind tells me there's a brother in here and there's a sister in here who is coming for a talk. Before I invite the pastors to come and pray, my brother, I ask you to come and help me. I'll ask our pianist just to lead us in a song. I don't know the number, but it's one of our hymn book songs. It says, I will follow thee, my Savior. You know that song? As that song is being played, friends, and the chorister is leading us, my mind is just telling me, you need to come. You may tell me to say, Pastor, the time is gone. No, it's because salvation is now. I have that burden. I feel you need to come. You may be outside. You may be somewhere. But you need to come now. This is your song. We will do the first stanza. We will do the second stanza. But we are doing it for you to walk in front. And I want you to walk in front. At this particular moment, friends, before they sing, just a minute. I want to invite one or two of our elders. Elders, I want you to walk in the congregation. Here are instructions, Elder. As you walk in the congregation, I want you to find somebody. Just extend your hand as an elder. Hold that hand of an elder and walk with him, the two of you coming from. Elders, let's get into the audience. Just call the elders and just call him. Say, Elder, let's walk together. Let them help you. Let Christ help you. Find that elder, just hold his hand. Elder, there are people who are outside. Somebody here, I have that burden. Before we pray, come with someone.
Yes, I will follow.
Amen, my sister. God bless you. What about you, my brother? God bless you. The elders are there. Just hold his hand and say, let's walk together.
Themselves to Pioneer Hill. They are not presenting themselves to Kabula SDA Church. We understand, God, that they are presenting themselves to you. May you receive them in a special way, Father.
Amen.
Father, they have chosen to be baptized. May the power of the Holy Spirit be with them. May you write their names in the book of life. As you receive them, may you also receive and forgive each one of us. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Father God, there is joy in heaven when one soul has returned to you. How about today, when we see all these souls standing up front that are ready to go into the water? They want to walk with you, Jesus. They want to also enter that kingdom. Yes, as you said very well, that when the owner of the garden hired workers, some went in the morning, some around 9, some 12, some in the afternoon, and others had to go last hour, but you all paid them the same amount. What I'm saying, Lord, this afternoon is, here are these souls that are ready to accept you. Use them in this last hour. That many souls that are perishing out there, after they have been baptized, work for you. The command is, who will go and who will serve me? And they are ready to go. Father, renew our vows as well, that as we are also going to experience what is going to take place, may we be rebaptized by the Holy Spirit. May you prepare us for the kingdom. Put all these differences away from us. We need to walk together as a family. Bless your children, bless your church, bless your preacher, and bless us all. For we pray and leave all this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this juncture, I will allow the elders to take your seats, except that, of course, you have now a duty that you should give the vows they should make as we are almost close to our meetings.